this step.
So, this is an example of Mr. J's P0 as musical pitches. This is my original row with my lucky charms converted to numbers and then converted again to musical pitches. And this is an example of those musical pitches arranged intervallically on the staff. And it sounds like this. Isn't that magically delicious? The final stages of 12-tone composition would include these final steps. This is not something that you need to do for this project, for this activity, but if you wanted to write a 12-tone composition, you would use the rows that you have created to create different rhythmic patterns to create melodies, monophonically, meaning one note at a time. You could also use the rows contrapuntally, so like you could do Bach style, but with 12-tone, so you set the melodies polyphonically against each other. You can use notes within a row to create chords, homophonically, like a Bach chorale. As long as you always maintain the row order, you can use any row you like, and you can use them in any rhythmic or textual pattern that you would like to do. Then, of course, you can add dynamics and articulations, you can add lyrics when appropriate, and you can orchestrate it for any instrumentation. You can write a 12-tone symphony, a 12-tone clarinet concerto, or a 12-tone opera, and believe me, many people have. Now I would like to take a little bit of time to apply this concept to an actual piece of music. We're going to look at Webern Symphony, Opus 21, Movement 2. And Webern is student of Schoenberg, who is known as the father of musical serialism. So if you turn in your textbooks, yes, those are the things that have been collecting dust for the last several weeks, perhaps months, and turn to page 424. On that page, you will find a listening guide for this piece. At the bottom of that page, page 424, you will see the original tone row used, his P0, from movement 1. A, F sharp, G, G sharp, E, F, B, B flat, D, C sharp, C, E flat. Next to it, you will see how he transposes that row up a half step and then inverts it. So it's in a transposition and an inversion of P0. So now that is B, D, C sharp, C, E, D sharp, A, B flat, F sharp, G, A flat, F. Now, keep that open, and also open your score packets that you received. It should say Contemporary Era Scores, 20th Century Europe and Beyond, and turn to page 52. If you analyze that score, you will see two things. First of all, in the flute part, you will see the retrograde inversion of the transposed inversion. So reading this backwards, where it says retrograde inversion, on the middle of page 424 in your books, you get F in the flute line, and then A flat, G, F sharp, B flat, A, D sharp, E, C, C sharp, D, B. Now, if you look in the lower voices of the orchestra, you hear the horns and the piano. He's using this idea called Klangfarben melody, which means passing those notes of the 12 pitches to different instruments. And he uses the inversion of the original row from movement 1 transposed up a major second, B, D, C sharp, C, E, and so forth. Music just got real. Excuse me, I don't know what came over me. My intention was simply to validate my sincere appreciation for the way that Webern utilizes the transposed inversion of his original row from the first movement, contrapuntally with the retrograde inversion of the same role, while maintaining the essence of Germanic orchestration technique of Klangfarben melody. Now that we have that all cleared up, let us listen to the resulting sound of the theme and variations from Webern's symphony, Opus 21, Movement 2.
Mr. Pope, there is no need to drop an atom bomb at this juncture. I am sure that this piece in no way reminds you of any Nickelback tune. This is your last reading assignment. My dear pupils, we are near the end. For next week, please complete page 135 to 137 in the study guides 141 to 142 on chapter 35. And if you did not finish filling out your matrix, please complete that by next Wednesday as well. Now, we have several different students represented here. Of course, up here on the right, we have Meadows, who is calmly and collectively, diligently studying. Down to the left, we have our IB students depicted here. And then, of course, here we have Emma Dilemma, asleep. So, which will you choose to be? Will you end strong, or will you, like our new friend, Vabon, retrogress? The choice is yours. I am so glad that before you could enjoy your weekend that you were properly notified at the hands of Mr. J's masterpiece theory. Please, dear pupils, enjoy your weekend, and of course, make smart choices. Cheerio!